So, good evening. I think it's time to start. First of all, let me introduce myself. I am real life Giuseppe Longo, Julien Ragu in Second Life. And I am an astrophysicist who works most of his time in Italy, in Naples, and some fraction of his time is spent in the United States at the California Institute of Technology. And tonight I'm here to speak about an ongoing revolution in astronomy, which is related to the survey. In a few seconds, you will understand better what we astronomers mean with this word survey. Tonight we have a little problem with the screen, so to change slides may be a little slower than usual, but let's try what we can do. And okay, what are surveys? Surveys are basically large field images of the sky, very large field. To give you an idea, a reference frame for what we are going to discuss tonight, the size of the full moon on the sky is half degree by half degree. And when I say wide field imaging, it means that to have a survey you need to cover at least 100 degrees by 100 degrees of the sky, and in some cases even the whole sky, as you will see. And surveys are just not images. I mean, they produce also very beautiful images, but they are incredibly useful for the advancement of science, because they allow you to measure a few important quantities for a very large number of objects. Basically, what you want out of a survey is to measure, first of all, the position of all the objects which you can see in the image, and therefore it's bi-dimensional position, so it's a position on the sky. Then if you have any way to estimate the distance of the object, you can transform this in a three-dimensional model of the universe by adding the distance to the position on the sky. Then you can measure observed brightness, how luminous a source appears to be. And since you can repeat this type of observations, putting different filters in front of your detector, basically, you can measure this brightness at different wavelengths. So this adds an extra dimension to the type of work which you can do with the surveys. And finally, since you can repeat these surveys over and over again, you can measure the flux of the same object many, many times over and over, so that at the end you can also study whether this object is a variable object or is an object of constant luminosity. The big advantage of surveys with respect to other types of astronomical measurement is that you can do this for incredibly large number of objects. So the first part of this talk will be historical, because in order to demonstrate to you that we are really undergoing the revolution, I first need to tell you what has been the scenery until a few years ago. We have three different periods for survey. There is one, the one which are called prehistory, which is before 1950, when most of the surveys were done with let's say with the small scale photographic plates, and therefore we were gathering information on the universe by measuring individual objects in small chunks of the sky. Then all these things were put together. Then there is a second period, which is between the 50s and the 80s, when the large scale photographic atlases were produced. We see a few cases of this. And then finally, we have what's going on now, which is the ongoing revolution, which is the digital surveys. In between this photographic plate and digital service period, there has been a transition era where all photographic plates were scannerized with the special machines, special equipment, and were transformed into digital service, but that was slightly different from what we do nowadays. So let's start from the very early beginning. At the very early beginning, date to a very, very distant in time date, basically, because the first catalog we have is one which was produced by Pappus in the second century before Christ, which was a catalog of the position of 850 stars visible to the naked eye. And this one was a very influential catalog. Even Ptolemy in his Almagest, which was the summa rerum of astronomy, even well into the Renaissance. Even Ptolemy copied Hipparchus' catalog and put in his book as his own, but actually it is. The real observation had been made by Parkos many centuries before. The subsequent evolution of the Parkos work was done by John Flamsteed in the 17th century, who was the first British astronomer royal, and he extended the Parkos catalog. But again, these observations were collected by visual means. There were no plates, no other way to record astronomical images, so these people were observing by naked eye at the telescope. And he obtained information for close to 3,000 stars. And in parallel, Charles Messier was also the first one to produce a catalog of non-stellar objects. Non-stellar object at that time was a mixed bag, where all objects which were not stars were put together. So you have a whole variety of objects, completely different in nature, like, you know, galactic clusters, globular clusters, planetary nebulae, stellar formation regions, and even external galaxies put all together. But not these catalogs, even though they were the results of a systematic observation of large regions of the sky, cannot be considered the surveys by any modern means. The first man who really performed a systematic survey of the sky was Frederick William Herschel, one of the best astronomers who ever lived. He was a German-born, British naturalized astronomer who was active between 1738-1822. And among the other things, he also was a discoverer of Uranus. But the most important contribution he did to science was a systematic search of the sky. Basically, he had as a goal to observe all the sky and to record the position of all objects which were entering the field of view of his telescope. And he, by doing this type of work, he was able to produce what you see in the lower right part of the screen, which is the first map of the distribution of the stars in our galaxy. This was the first scientific proof that our sun is located inside the stellar system, which is highly flattened, and Herschel estimated the flattening ratio into 5 to 1. So basically, the sun is inside the distribution, which is 5 times longer than thicker. Obviously, it was a very naive representation, but at that time, modern astrophysics was far from existing. I mean, it was still in very early stages of development, so there were a lot of wrong assumptions, and also, you know, the understanding of the measurement was not as trivial as it could be today. In any case, Herschel, besides counting stars, also did something much more important. He systematically measured the position and the morphology of almost 3,000 nebulae. Even nowadays, I mean, these objects are still numbered according to his own catalog. The new general catalog was produced by Herschel. So when you see a galaxy with the name NGC followed by a number, that label comes out of Herschel catalog. And he basically was capable to observe more than 3,000 galaxies, to derive information on their morphology, on their properties. And he used this data to derive, you know, several important properties without going into the detail, because this is not the main goal of this presentation. I think that his most important contribution are these two images, which I'm showing now. Because after having produced a classification for 3,000 extended objects, he also tried to classify them and to put a physical meaning behind this classification. Since at that time, people were convinced that the universe as described by Newton, a universe which was ruled by the force of gravity alone, was not stable, and therefore all dispersed objects having enough time would have ended up collapsing, coalescing on each other. So Herschel took this very early Newtonian point of view and made a classification of the objects which he had observed in the sky in based on the degree of central concentration, saying objects which are more centrally condensed are in a more advanced phase of collapse and therefore they are older. And to my knowledge, this is the first time that an astronomer or a physicist, you know, destroyed the last part of the Aristotelic paradigm, you know, by saying the universe is not static, the universe is evolving. So in some sense, by making this classification, Herschel also introduced the concept of the evolution of the universe, which is one on which modern cosmology is based. So with Herschel, I mean, we can close this prehistory of surveys and go to the second stage. The second stage, which was one of the most interesting periods of the history of astronomy, is strictly related to the advent of photographic plates. Photographic plates had been around for a while, but almost immediately the pioneer of the field tried to obtain images of celestial objects. The one on the left, I think, is the oldest astronomical image ever taken. It's an image of the moon taken by Daguerre in 1839. It's, the moon is barely recognized, but while on the left was the one on the right was taken in 1851 by the great American photographer John Adams, who made a quite impressive portrait of the moon, as you can see. What was the advantage of the plates? One is obvious. I mean, you didn't need to measure the position and the brightness of the object by naked eye while standing in the telescope, but you could take your photographic plate and bring it home, you know, in your laboratory, and there, you know, measure the properties of the stars at your ease. I mean, with much more carefully with sitting in a warm room and not in a cold dome of an observatory. So basically it made possible to have a more systematic work and more detailed analysis of these plates. And one additional advantage is that these plates could be stored forever. So by comparing plates in different time, you could, you know, even study important properties of the celestial objects, like, for instance, temporal variability, and all variety of phenomena. As it always happens, when you adopt a new technology, there are people who become the founding father of the field. And I think that in the case of photographic surveys, the real founding father is this man you see here in this picture, who is Emerson Barnard. And I think it's worth to spend a few words on this man, because this was, is one of those fantastic stories which would deserve a novel by a good writer. He was a very poor guy, American born, and he found himself involved in astronomy for the simple reason that when he was six, in order to help his mother in providing for the family, he was hired to do the weirdest job I have ever heard of. You see in the central picture, you see the first version of a what nowadays would be called a photographic enlarger, what you use, you know, to transform the negative of a film into a positive print. So basically you take the negative exposed to light, project it on the piece of paper, and then you fix the image on the paper, you develop it, and you get the normal photographs. At that time, these machines were like the one you see in this picture. They were huge. Since the process was not very efficient, they needed a lot of light. The only source of light available at that time capable to, to do such a work was the sun. So the whole camera was steerable. And here you see the hole on the left you see the hole from which the sunlight was entering. And the whole thing had to be pointed toward the sun. So how do you do that? You put a small kid inside this wooden frame, and with the system of pulleys, this guy is, making sure that the image of the sun produced by the entrance lens were falling always in the same place of the device. It was an incredibly dangerous job. More than 100 kids got killed doing this for a simple reason. Inside the wooden frame, closed because no light could enter from the other side, the temperature rose very quickly, and so the kids became sleepy. And when they were falling asleep, they lost control. They all obviously lost control of the tracking, and the sun drifted away from the focal plane, hitting the wooden walls, and so putting the whole machine on fire. And this was a well-paid job, but it was also a very dangerous one. And Emerson became incredibly skilled at that, and this basically gave him the expertise which was needed to become an exceptional night assistant for an astronomical observatory. So basically, he had become so careful, so attentive in keeping the telescope pointed toward the sun that for him it was very, very easy to maneuver, the early telescope of the early 20th century. So he was hired first at Leek, then he moved to Harvard. He made a very solid reputation for himself, and his main contribution was the first photographic atlas of the Milky Way, and he was capable to produce some images that even nowadays are among the most beautiful images we have of our galaxy. And from these images, thousands and thousands of the discoveries were made by him and mainly by others. But for instance, these were also the first images where it became clear that in the galaxy there were patches of dust interposed between the luminous background and the observer. These black spots, which you see, are not regions devoid of stars, but regions where between the stars which are in the background and the observer, there is a large chunk of absorbing interstellar material, in particular dust, which stops the light from the stars which are behind. And Barnard discovered the existence of these dark clouds, as he called them, and made also the first catalog of these objects. Obviously, As soon as the technology was mature, many people began to work for the first real whole sky surveys ever produced. And the most important and the most influential one is surely the one which was made at the Palomar Observatory, using a new type of telescope, which was a Schmidt telescope. Basically, these are very, very intriguing telescope from the point of view of the optical design, which allow you to have a very large field of view with corrected from all sorts of aberrations, so that you could produce with a single large plate a very reliable, very accurate image of a very large portion of the sky. And in the case of the Schmidt-Toshkin, Palomar Schmidt-Toshkin, which is here in the picture, they were capable to get images of a regional sky of 36 square degrees, basically 6 by 6 degree image of the sky, which was absolutely impressive. And obviously these were obtained on photographic plates, then these were printed, and they were distributed along the world. I mean, now we live in the age of internet, you know, and I just turned 60, so I don't consider myself old, but here the guy with the spectacles on the right is a very young me. I had just become an astronomer, and as you can see, I'm smiling very happily because, you know, we just had received from Palomar the first shipment of the Palomar Sky Atlas, the collection of the plates which had been printed. And as you can see, it was a quite impressive bulk of material. Now, the most incredible thing is that all the information which was in this huge, incredible archive of plates is contained in a very small, even in a USB pen, a large USB pen. You know, it's really unbelievable. But at that time, you know, it was absolutely incredible to be able to access, you know, a photographic atlas of the sky, which was formed by more than 2,000 different plates. The plates had been taken in different wavelengths, and therefore, you know, it was possible to do a lot of interesting work from this. In each plate, to give you an idea, there were between 10 to the 5, between 100,000 and 1 million objects. So it was absolutely incredible for astronomy. In the Palomar Sky Survey was just the forerunner of a long sequence of photographic surveys. I will not enter into the detail, but this survey produced a huge amount of sites. I mean, more than 5,000-6,000 papers on international scientific journals came out of these photographic atlases. Here you have just the list of some of the most important contributions, the first catalog of clusters and galaxy clusters made by Fritz Zwick, the morphological galaxy catalog by Voronzov-Velianin, the catalog of galaxy cluster by George Abel, and you know, many, 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 many others. In any case, while these photographic atlases were still being collected, I mean, with the telescopes working night after night to the acquisition of these plates, there was the beginning of the transition era. Plates, for the first time, could be transformed into digital information. There was this machine, which you see here on the picture on the right, which was called the microdensitometer. On the bottom you see a layout of how it works. But basically you have this machine had a very small pencil beam of light, absolutely stable, absolutely calibrated. And this pencil beam was positioned on a point of the plate. And by measuring the light which was passing on the other side, so the transmitted light, by knowing how much light you were putting on the on the point, basically, by the ratio of these two quantities, incident light and transmitted light, you could estimate the density of the plate, how dark was the image of the object. And this darkness, this was a direct correlation with the luminosity of the object. And so for the first time, you could measure in a sort of objective manner the luminosity of an object out of this large photographic plate. And this obviously started the worldwide effort, you know, to transform these photographic atlases in matrices. And one of the most famous is the one which you see here. It's the APM, Automatic Plate Measuring Machine in Cambridge, which made the first catalog, first digital catalog of the objects contained in 185 plates. The region was chosen around the southern galactic pole of the Sesta Sphere for a lot of reasons, which if you wish I can explain to you later. And for the first time, astronomers began to deal with huge numbers of objects. But that was a real revolution. We had, we were used to work with the 10 objects. In most cases, if you have to do your PhD thesis, you were working on 50 objects. Here you had a survey which was providing the community with the 20 of objects, with the apparent position, magnitude, in some cases also shape of parameters. And here you see the first attempt to reproduce a bi-dimensional map of the universe as it was observed by APM. Each single dot here represents the position of a galaxy. So this was our first map of the galaxy distribution, such a large scale. Okay, it takes a few seconds for me to visualize the image. The true turning point was when the United States had to launch the Hubble Space Telescope. Hubble Space Telescope was revolutionary under many respects, but the main problem is that in order, it was so accurate that it was not possible to use standard catalogs to point the telescope. It was badly needed to have a guide star catalog. What does it mean? Basically, to have a reference catalog of several thousand stars for which the position and the luminosity had to be known with an incredible accuracy so that the telescope could use these stars to find its position on the sky. The construction of this guide star catalog started an international effort which lasted more than almost two decades. It was started at the Hubble Space Telescope and the California Institute of Technology. The first behind this effort was Lasker, who was a scientist at the Hubble Space Telescope. He's the one who set the standard, you know, for the digitalization of this plate. And the first thing he did, it was to digitalize the first Palomar Sky Survey and the second Palomar Sky Survey, what we call the POS-1, POS-2 circle, which were all the photographic atlases which had been collected over the year. And from this, he derived the guide star catalog for the Hubble Space Telescope. A few years later, George Orgowski, who I think has given talk here in Science Circle, is a current professor of astronomy at the California Institute of Technology, started the digital Palomar Sky Survey project, which was using, in practice, the same material which had been digitized by the Hubble Space Telescope. And in order to obtain a better photometric accuracy, he made an impressive effort, together with this collaborator, to take at least two or three images with large telescope using this new type of the detectors which was beginning to emerge in those years, which are the CCDs. These are digital detectors which nowadays we use everywhere. They are, you know, in the in the camera of your mobile, they are in the camera of any digital camera, they are at the focus of any telescope. But in the 80s, it was a moment that technology was still in its infancy. But in any case, these detectors were allowing people to obtain a very accurate measurement of the light coming from the celestial object. So George started this DPOS project, which aimed at calibrating the whole Palomar sky survey using dedicated images taken at the large telescope. And he also produced the first modern catalog. I will explain you better what I mean with this in a few minutes. The first modern catalog and also the first public catalog, because I think that the true revolution behind surveys is not only in the size of the object, which or the catalog, millions, or nowadays we talk about hundreds of millions and even billions of objects, for which you have a huge amount of information, which could not be foreseen at all 20 years ago, but also the fact that this data become immediately public. So survey data can be accessed by everyone in the world. Doesn't matter whether he's a professional or not. I mean, you just need to have the address or the place where to go. You can download the data. And this was a revolution which was dictated by the sheer size of the data which were produced by survey. And George was one of the pioneers who preached this public approach to surveys. Okay, let me explain you what basically you need to do once you have a large image of the sky. In an image of the sky, like the one which you show here, which I show here, this is a 30 arc minutes by 30 arc minutes patch of the sky, the same size of the full moon. If you observe it with a moderate size of the telescope, let's say with the 2.5 meter telescope, in that small patch of the sky, you have a minimum of 50,000 objects. The red dots which you see are, you know, on the right. For each one of these, obviously, you don't see them in the central image just because there is not enough dynamical range to show it in a photograph. But if you go to measure the amount of information which is contained there, you discover that there is something like 55,000-60,000 objects. For each one of these objects, you need first to recognize the existence of the object. Then you need to extract the object from the image and to measure for this object all possible parameters. What does it mean, possible parameters? For each object, you obviously have a position. You have the time, the epoch at which the observation was made. Then you have the luminosity of the object at that time. And then if the object is not point-like, but it's a little extended, you have a lot of other information, like the gradient of the luminosity profile of the object, like the concentration of the light on the object, and so on. This means that if you do things carefully, you end up for each object with a list of somewhere between 100 and, in modern survey, even 1,000 different parameters, which are all measured from the survey. Impressive, the amount of information which you can derive from a single image. I'm talking about, in the worst case, 100 independent measures of the properties of that little tiny spot you observe on the plate. Therefore, when you are dealing with 100 million objects, for each one of them you measure 300 parameters, you end up with a table which will be 100 million rows and 300 columns. Absolutely unmanageable. Not even with the, I mean, it can be stored on computer, but even in this way, it's very difficult to manage, to extract information from these things. And this is why we talk about a paradigmatic shift in what's happening in astronomy. The beginning of this shift was the impressive work done by the Sloan Foundation, who financed the first digital survey of the sky, what we know nowadays called the SDSS, the Sloan Digital Sky Survey, which has been the has set the stage for all the surveys which have come afterwards, which will come in the future. Basically, thanks to Alex Zalay, Jim Gunn, many other outstanding minds of our last century, and also this century, thanks God they are all alive. They basically systematically observed a large chunk of the northern sky using a telescope at Apache Point, which is shown, I think, in the next slide. And this is not here, sorry. Let me see if I can find it, and then we go back. No? Let me see. No. Okay. And basically, it's a dedicated telescope which was only acquiring images for the Sloan. They ended up with 2.5 terapixel. Each pixel is 8 bytes. So basically, this means 10 terabytes of raw data. And already was an impressive amount. At that time, it was frightening. Nowadays, it's something which I have on my PC at home. I have a RAID with 16 terabytes of data. But these 10 terabytes of data were 400 terabytes of processor data, 0.5 terabytes of catalog, for a total, let's say, of useful data of the order of 35 terabytes. These data were immediately made public, which means that everyone in the world could use, download the data and do its own research. And it has been the most successful experiment ever made in astronomy. Out of the Sloan, as today, have come almost more than 10,000 refereed papers, scientific papers. And of these 10,000 papers, less than one-tenth were made by the authors of the survey, by the people who really made the survey. Nine-tenths of this scientific contribution came from people living all over the world who were capable to access this huge amount of first quality data and to make their own science out of this data. I want to spend a few words about this. I think that in this respect, astronomy is truly an outstanding, because astronomy is a truly international science. Since our data have no added value, basically, there is no privacy involved, because basically there is no sensitive data contained. Since there are really no international boundaries, I mean, we are one of the Sloan Digital Sky Survey is the first example of truly democratic science. Everyone with a computer connection anywhere in the world, if he had enough brain or enough knowledge to have a good idea, could download this data and produce outstanding first-class science without being dependent on the availability of large telescopes, which usually are only in the richest countries, or being without the need to be in large university or in famous university. So I think that survey, also not only from the scientific point of view, but also from the sociological point of view and from the political point of view, the digital surveys have had an incredible impact on on modern science, on modern astronomical science. Let me move quickly, just to give you an idea. What this is, Sloan is a word. I mean, once you start working with it, I mean, you discover every day new feature, but they were intelligent enough to add to the photometry also a lot of spectroscopic information, so that really you can find whatever you need inside the Sloan. And here you have the first problem. When you in Sloan at the moment, you have 300 million objects, and for each one of them, you have 1,000 parameters. How do you use this information? Let us assume that I want to select from this object those which are stars from those which are galaxies. What do I do? Do I investigate each object by eye? Even having 10 PhD students dumb enough to devote their entire existence to this task, it will take thousands and thousands of years to do that. So you need to record to machines. And digital surveys have been a revolution also because they have marked a transition in the way astronomers approach their data. Astronomy has entered the big data era. So basically, nowadays, most of the trivial tasks, and even some of the most complex tasks, are no longer performed by humans, but are performed by machine learning, the equivalent of artificial intelligence. So basically, you teach machine how to do complex tasks, which in the past could only be done by human operator. And therefore, machine learning, data mining, advanced statistics, statistical pattern recognition, which are all tools which lay beyond advanced visualization, I was forgetting this one, which are tools which are usually in the domain of artificial intelligence, robotics, and so on, have entered astronomy vehemently. So basically, nowadays you cannot even think, as you will see in a few seconds, to do a survey without having a large fraction of your budget devoted to design specific intelligent software to take care of most of the tasks. I'm particularly sensitive about that because this is exactly what my group works on. I'm quite sensitive to this point. Sorry, I took the wrong slide. Let me find the right one. Here we are. I think this is this one, yes. Let me see it. Okay, I still cannot see it. Okay. One additional piece of information is that after the Sloan, the effectiveness of the Sloan, the huge scientific throughput of the Sloan has motivated many institutes in doing the same type of work. So we have, I have here a few examples. One of very successful modern surveys, Catalina real-time transient survey, which covered the smaller patch of the sky than Sloan, but it observed it repeatedly, because at that point the interest was not only to see how many objects and how bright they were, but also how many of these objects were changing over time and how many of these objects were doing very quickly. So this Catalina real-time transient survey was the first synoptic survey, as we say. Basically, it was a survey dedicated to the time domain, which is also a dimension which has been opened by digital surveys. And let's say that already a few years it was operational, they had discovered 6,000 unique type of object which suddenly increased their magnitude by factor of 5, factor of 10. So, and this has led to discovery of more than 1,500 supernovae, 1,000 cataclysmic variables, an incredible number of AGN, of blazars, and so on. So, and this again has produced a huge public archive. If you go to the location of the Catalina Sky Survey, you can find an archive of online of light curves for something like 500 million objects. So you can download a work on 500 or million light curves like those which you see here, where you see a whole variety of variable objects. So again, anywhere who has an interest in this type of topics, regardless where he is in the world, can access an incredible amount of information and use it for his own research. The same was done also in other wavelengths. I'm not going to give you all the examples because surveys nowadays are very common. You do it in far infrared, in ultraviolet, in other domains. But at this point, you may have heard about this, there was a problem. If you have so many surveys and each one of them is several tens of terabytes of data, and for instance you want to cross-correlate the properties of your object as observed in visible light with the properties of the same object in infrared, what do you do? Do you transfer 10 terabytes of data from one survey, 10 terabytes of data from another survey, so basically 20 terabytes of data over the network to your computer? This is impossible. No network could endure such stress. I mean, in principle, it could be possible, but that network should be dedicated for a week only to transfer this data, so which is basically not feasible. And the astronomical community became very well aware of this problem already in 2000, where we had the first meeting in Pasadena at Caltech, which was virtual observatory of the future. And the American National Science Foundation decided to fund the so-called virtual observatory. Virtual observatory is basically that, the possibility to federate and to operate from all over the world all available data. Again, astronomy is a fantastic example of international cooperation. We had 800 people, more or less, from 27 different national projects working all together to make available to the community at large, even to the layman, the whole astronomical data repository of the world. The virtual observatory basically is over now because the goal was reached, and now we are beginning to use the huge possibilities, to use the huge potentialities which have been implemented with the virtual observatory. Okay, let me move to the last part of the talk, which is about the near future. Near future is frightening from this point of view because technology progresses at an incredible speed, and we have these two monsters coming on. The largest synoptic survey telescope, LSST, will become operational in near 2020, not 2019, 2020. You remember the whole DPOS was 30 terabytes. The largest synoptic survey telescope, I will give you a few minutes. More details in a few seconds, we produce 30 terabytes of data per night. And this is still not in comparison to the square kilometer array, SKA, which will produce 1 exabyte of per day, not second, sorry, there is a mistake, of the raw data. 1 exabyte means 1 million of terabytes per second, per day. We know how to deal with the data streams coming out from the large synoptic survey telescope. We still have no idea of how to deal with the data stream which will come out of the SKA. And there is a huge community of scientists at the moment trying to figure out how to analyze, how to acquire, analyze, process, and store this amount of data. Let me spend a few more words on LSST because it's really a fantastic endeavor. This is an 8 meter class telescope you see here on the right. Here on the left you see the blank of the mirror after it came out of the furnace. The people around the mirror give you an idea of the size of the machine. And this machine is basically a survey monster. It will close the discussion, the topic for many, many years to come. It has a huge camera, 3.2 gigapixel camera. Each image, the correct field of view of the telescope is 16 degrees, so basically it's 40 times the size of the full moon. And it is expected to produce data for 37 billion, 37,000 million stars and galaxies. And each one of these objects will be covered basically every 4 days. So, the whole sky accessible by the telescope, which will be the southern sky, will be covered over and over every 4 days. And this amount of data will be basically a cornucopia of a scientific discovery, which will become available to the public the very same moment it has been acquired. Therefore, you know, it is an interesting future ahead. One last set of considerations, and this is more philosophical rather than technological, but I need to do this. Because it's otherwise people could think that surveys are only a shift in size. No, they're a shift in complexity. They're bound to push knowledge beyond the limitation of the human brain. Let me put things like this. Every parameter you measure adds a dimension in the parameter space. So basically, if you measure three parameters, your observation is a point in a three-dimensional parameter space. If you measure four parameters, you are dealing with the four-dimensional parameter space, but you are already lost because our human brain is not capable to work in more than three dimensions. The parameter space which are covered by modern surveys have more than 300, 400 dimensions. Now, there is a very simple consideration which needs to be done. I'll come back to this slide later on. Let me move to this one. All science, as we know nowadays, all science, not only astronomy, physics, and so on, relies at most on three independent variables. Any law which we know, the Hooke law for the stress, the ideal gas law, and so on, basically has at most three independent variables. So basically you can have pressure, temperature, and volume. You can have stress and strength. You can have mass, distance, and force. But three parameters. Is it a property of the universe in which we live, or is it just a limitation of the human brain? Our human brain is not capable to perceive pattern, perceive structures in more than three dimensions. So therefore, all empirical laws which we discover in nature are at most based on three parameters. Eventually, we can find the fourth parameter which slips in if we know some anomalies and so on. But basically, out of the richness of the information which is provided to us by nature, we can dig out only third-order correlations between three parameters. So what is hiding in this huge database which are producing the surveys, where you have 300, 400 parameters? How can you dig out the new science, the more complex science, the higher order properties and laws of physics which are surely hiding inside this huge database? The only way to do this is to overcome the human limitation. And you can do this only by using machine learning, recurring to artificial intelligence. Machines don't care about three dimensions. They are capable to find mathematical correlation, mathematical patterns in spaces as of high dimensionality, as high as you want. And I give you just one last example, and then I think we can finish. Here you have, on the left, the way astronomers used to select quasar, you know, this very high redshift distant object, very luminous, with a two-dimensional diagram. You can see you have a red line, which is a cutoff line. The objects on the left are stars. The objects in the green ellipse are ambiguous. The object in the blue ellipses are good candidates. But if you add the third parameter, you end up in the same situation you are on the right, where those objects, which in two dimensions appear projected one over the other, in three dimensions are much better separated, just because the third dimension can increase the distance between one distribution and the other. So here you see an immediate advantage. The region which originally was the green ellipses is this cloud of points, green points down here, which is completely separated, and therefore you don't have a liquid anymore. Below, you see a new way of looking at the data, where we are projecting a 21 parameter space on the surface of a sphere, where you see how the same objects are completely separated in different groups. Each of these groups is a type of object which was slightly different from the other, but this could not be recognized as long as you were relying on your three-dimensional perception of the world. Therefore, let me finish with this simple consideration. Surveys have shaped the past of astronomy, but what is more important, for sure, they have changed the present of astronomy, and they are bound to produce a huge increase in our scientific knowledge. For two reasons. First, because we will be able to explore information on very large samples and therefore to have higher statistical significance for all the phenomena. But what is more important, the complexity which is intrinsic to these data sets will allow us to discover a science of a higher order of complexity which so far has completely escaped. I think I'm done, so if there is any question, I'd be very happy to answer. Hello? Thank you. Any question? Thank you very much. I think the fondue is waiting for someone. Well, this is an interesting question. I mean, basically, you need a good computer, a good PC. No, even a power Mac is okay, or something, because you need to have some computational power. Then the access of the data is trivial. You can just go to the virtual observatory side and download all the tools which you need to access the database or to download your data, to make your queries to the database and so on. Therefore, or you go to the Sloan database where you have a CAS job which allows you, you know, to download what you want. For what data mining is concerned, there are many different options. Basically, you need to have a basic understanding of these tools, so I would recommend always to follow, you know, one of these short course, online courses on machine learning, just to understand exactly what they do. But then, basically, it's plenty of tools which are completely free, and you can download from SourceForge, it's open source code, or, you know, tools for proprietary software like MATLAB, who has several toolboxes, you know, for data mining. Therefore, it's truly a democratic thing. So the only thing you need is to have a determination to do it, because at the beginning, you know, to extract information from these data sets is not so easy, just because you need to acquire some skill, but Let me put things like this. A student of mine becomes familiar with these things in less than a couple of weeks. Yeah, very, very exciting. It's an exciting field of research. Can you talk about how this data? Oh, yes. Oh, yeah, of course. I mean, because, well, at the moment, the discovery of asteroids are obviously you can discover asteroids only on multi-epoch surveys, when you take images of the same part of the sky over and over, because you recognize an asteroid by the fact that it moves from one image to the other, and therefore you need to have several epochs. In the past, only few surveys, general purpose surveys, were doing this, but there were dedicated surveys made by NASA mainly, and also by a network of telescopes around the world, were surveying the ecliptic plane, looking, you know, for these hazardous hazardous asteroids, those which are risky for our planet. But to tell you the truth, since this line of research was not well funded, because, you know, nations prefer to spend more money in nukes rather than to destroy our planets, rather than to protect it. These telescopes were usually very small, and being very small, they could not go very deep, so they could not see the very faint one, which are the true dangers. The machine which is going to settle the issue once forever is a large synoptic survey telescope. It is expected that every night the large synoptic survey telescope will discover something like 100,000 new asteroids. Basically, it will be a continuous monitoring of the sky, at least over the part of the sky which is covered by LSST, which is more than half of the celestial sphere. So I think that we really can expect a quite complete census of asteroids, you know, only after LSST will have been operational for a couple of years. Let me put things like this. Man-made objects in orbit, yes, but we know the position almost. Of course, I mean, if they are large satellites, they leave tracks and they are discovered on the... But you know, there is one difference. Asteroids are different from Earth satellites, artificial satellites. Because artificial satellites basically are usually not very distant and they move very fast. So even on a single image, you spot the asteroid because it leaves a very elongated trail of the image. It's not like stars which are point-like, you just have a very elongated trail. So to have a complete census of satellites is not very difficult. Again, space debris, basically the screws, the bolt, all the garbage which has been left around the Earth, the detectability of these objects depends on how large they are and therefore how numerous they are. And once more, when LSST will become operational, since it is an 8-meter telescope, we expect that we can be able to track down all objects small, larger than 1 centimeter around the orbit. Yeah. There are initial satellites in the orbit for short periods. What do you mean? I don't understand the question. Oh yeah, but you know, they still follow the Kepler's laws. So basically, they like, I mean, doesn't matter whether it is a natural satellite or a satellite. Once you are in orbit, that is your speed. Your speed depends on the distance. So basically, the limitation is in the sides, in how much light you reflect. I mean, most large satellites, you see them even by naked eye, like the International Space Station or, you know, the Hubble Space Telescope. You see them by naked eye. In a dark night, you can see them very easy. The smaller they are, the less luminous they are. And therefore, in order to detect them, you need a larger telescope. One with LSST, as I said, you will see objects with the size of little more than 1 centimeter. So that will make a complete census of what's happening around our planet, basically. Seems like there are no other questions. Okay. In this case, I thank you all of you again for being here in Science Circle, and it is always a pleasure for me to give this talk. So thank you very much for having attended the lecture. Thank you. Oh, yeah. Just one last question. Let me see. I've lost it. It was too early. Cosmo, this is a good question. Well, in order to be more confident, we will need another LSST covering the northern sky. Northern hemisphere, because you know LSST will be in Chile, so it will cover the southern sky. We will need another telescope like that one covering also the northern sky. Obviously, I mean, if you cannot observe a region of the sky, you cannot know what is there. So there will be, let's say, 40% of the sky where we'll be sort of, let's say, blind, because we don't have a powerful enough telescope. Okay, so I think I'm ready for my dinner, because in Italy it's 8:30 in the evening, and since I'm from the south, I mean, this is for me time to start preparing the dinner. Never dinner before 9:30, so, but I need to go. So thank you very much, and I hope to be here again soon. Bye, everybody. Thank you very much. You too. Nice breakfast.